In the Roman history of the world, Britain was just a short chapter in the story of an empire which stretched from Carlisle to Cairo and lasted for hundreds of years. Well, how do we find out what happened here in this island nearly 2,000 years ago? Well, some Roman historians wrote down some of what went on, and standing in the classics section of a well-known bookshop chain, I can see the spines of several dozen books that have come down to us from the ancient world. For years and years, the story of the Romans has been paraded as a set of certainties, hard historical facts, by the ranks of subbuffton tuftons. Well, don't believe a word of it. You're going to find a story that is completely different, but twice as fascinating as anything you half remember from school.
The Romans in Britain. Written and presented by Guy de la Bédoyère. Part 1. Let's look at the evidence. Guy, it's over to you.
Let's follow a path back through history and see what we can find out with any certainty about our past. The first date on British history is 55 BC, when Julius Caesar came with his army to Britain. He was attempting an invasion. It wasn't very successful, and he had to come back the following year, and even that didn't work out very well. He had problems in Gaul, and that was the end of it. The real invasion of Britain didn't come for another 90 years. The year 43, 10 years or so after the death of Christ. That was when the Emperor Claudius' army arrived in Britain, and it all came about because a British king, or a chieftain, called Verica, who was under a threat from a neighbouring tribe in Britain, came over to Rome and said, "Please come and help me." For the Emperor Claudius, this was a wonderful excuse to invade Britain. And by the way, that's the I Claudius of the book by Robert Graves and the television series. And we know what happened thanks to the writings of the historian Dio Cassius.
Claudius, a very distinguished senator, commanded a campaign to Britain, because a certain Verica, forced out of the island after a rebellion, had persuaded Claudius to send an army there.
Now the trouble is that Dio was writing so long after the events that he was describing had taken place, that for all we know, he was making up a very good story out of an odd few facts he'd managed to gather together in the archives in Rome.
They made it to Britain and landed without opposition. The Britons ran away to the marshes and forests.
Now, Dio goes on to tell us a little bit more about Claudius' invasion in greater or lesser detail, but it's mainly recorded to make Claudius, like all Roman emperors, seem all the more impressive. Now, how would we know that that invasion had taken place if that document, that history, had been lost? Well, there's the evidence of Roman coinage. Do you remember that 50-pence piece with the clasped hands on the reverse? It's supposed to commemorate Britain joining the European Union. Now, it is a good comparison, but of course it only circulated in Britain. In the Roman Empire, coins circulated all the way across Europe and North Africa, and the emperors used them as a perfect way of telling the public about their great achievements.
The Emperor Claudius put a picture of his triumphal arch in Rome onto his coins to celebrate his victory in Britain. It was fine to put up a triumphal arch in Rome, but how many people actually got to see it? Not very many in terms of the empire as a whole. Much more efficient was to put a picture of that on his coins, and many of the people who looked at those coins would have understood exactly the way he was boasting about his conquest of Britain.
So Roman coins can actually tell us rather a lot about what happened, but evidence like that is a bit of a lottery. You never know which bits are going to survive and which bits aren't. Now, the most famous document about the Great Fire of London has to be the diary of Samuel Pepys. And how else would we know it had happened if he hadn't written about it so vividly? Well, we've got the story here in London, written up on a stone inscription at the bottom of the monument. And I'm sure you're ahead of me now. Anyone who was anyone in the Roman world wrote down about themselves, what they'd done and their great achievements on stone inscriptions. And if those survive, and many of them do, we can read what happened, and some of them tell us a tremendous amount.
We've got one of the best building inscriptions from the northern frontier, and the clearest and best preserved and most beautifully cut. It records the introduction of a water supply to the fort at South Shields in the year AD 222. And we know that because it's got the name of the governor on, who's called Marius Valerianus. It's also got the name of the emperor, M. Aurelius. M is for Marcus Aurelius, Severus.
Well, Marcus Aurelius Severus is better known to history as the Emperor Severus Alexander, but what that inscription, of course, doesn't actually say is the year AD 222. So how do we know that we can date that inscription to that year? Well, Roman emperors had titles. They held a series of various official posts in Rome as well as being emperor, like consul, like tribune, and those were normally renewed every year. Those titles were written down and carved onto huge stone inscriptions, many of which have survived, and others which were copied down by medieval monks. And the survival of those lists makes it possible for you, me, or anyone to look up the Emperor Severus Alexander and see when he was consul and tribune for the first time, as recorded on that inscription at South Shields, and we find out that it was in the year 222.
I suspect with a lot of these stones that most people wouldn't have read them after they were unveiled. The vital thing is the ceremony when somebody comes along, unveils it, and everybody claps and there's a general feeling of goodwill all round. But with most building inscriptions that we see today, I mean, how many times do people look at these inscriptions after they've unveiled them?
Surely inscriptions like that haven't got anything to do with you or me. Well, they have. Tombstones. The tombstones of your ancestors and my ancestors. And if you wanted to, you could go out and build up a family tree by the information that's listed on the tombstones about how long people lived and their names. And because they're made of stone, they're wonderful and hard-wearing. So if you break them or move them about, you can still find out useful information. And they're a wonderful source of detail about the Romans.
This gives us her name, Regina. It tells us that she was the freedwoman and wife of a man called Barates, who was a Palmyrene. That means he came from modern-day Syria. But she herself, it goes on to say, was a member of the nation or tribe of the Catavellauni. This means she was British. She came from the area around St. Albans. And it then finishes off by telling us that she died at the age of 30.
And we'll hear more about that Romano-British lady later. Now, the problem is for an archaeologist that although we've got our written history, our coins and our sculpture, we're really not going to get very much more of that kind of thing. So the future, the way of finding out more about the Romano-British, is what we can uncover in the ground. Now, I'm upstairs in my bedroom, in my own semi-detached house here, and you might be in an upstairs room in your house while you're listening to this programme. The fact is that if you moved out tomorrow and your whole house fell down, and it was abandoned, and an archaeologist came to dig it up, he or she would be just left with the foundations. That's all he or she would have to go on to work out what your life had been like, your family, your interests, and unless bits of your upstairs floor had happened to collapse in and amongst the rubbish, it can be almost impossible to work out what your life had been like. And that's the problem that confronts Romano-British archaeologists all the time. Now, generations of buffed and tufted and type archaeologists from decades and centuries ago created this wonderful image of the Roman period as being just full of fire and the sword, an awful lot of vicious, exciting activity. If a house had been burnt down, then it must have been burnt down by marauding raiders. Is that really true, though?
Certainly the barracks all burnt down. It may have been accidental, it may have been deliberate in that the Romans decided, the garrison decided they need to rebuild and they torched the buildings as a quick way of demolishing them. And we still can't rule out the possibility that the fort was actually attacked and burnt, although that sort of idea is less fashionable than it used to be.
There's a sort of scalloping at the tops of the stone slabs which line the tank.
What about this as a piece of evidence from Hausted's fort on Hadrian's Wall?
In the past, this was always said to be where the Roman soldiers sharpened their swords or spears or some other sort of beastly military function. We find the same sort of wear on stone slabs at Corbridge, for instance, and it's something that you'll recognise if you go to Mediterranean villages, and it's where you'll see people washing their clothes, beating the hell out of their sort of their toga, well, not their togas, because nobody wore a toga at Hausted's, out of their breeches and their other garments. So this is effectively a sort of washateria.
So we've discovered that if we take archaeology and put it together with history, we can end up with a really rather rigid picture of the past, unless we're very careful. But there is help at hand. This is what something as simple as a roof tile can tell us. Right, so we're in the museum here at Durham, looking into one of the many display cases of Roman items, and I'm looking at a large fragment of Roman roof tile, and written across it, in what looks just like ordinary handwriting, are three Latin words. Now, Martin, what does that actually tell us? Not just in terms of what the words mean, but what does it tell us about Latin and the Roman Britons?
Celtic languages have an oral tradition, but no written tradition. And the emergence of writing in Roman Britain completely changes the character of what a society...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.